Welcome to Gartner ThinkCast. I'm Alexis Waringa. This week, we're exploring the emerging technologies that will redefine the future of business. From polyfunctional robots to preemptive cybersecurity, these trends, accelerated by AI, will impact enterprises of all sizes across various business models. Pulled from our on-demand webinar on the 12 emerging technologies, Gartner distinguished VP analyst Bill Ray will walk through the most important of these disruptions and how leaders should begin to respond to both mitigate risk and roadmap for competitive advantage. Now, here's Bill.
We believe at Gartner that being able to see the variation in the future is absolutely critical. And the reason that we call these disruptors is because they are things that you cannot ignore. These are things which are going to change your business whether you want them to or not. They are the things that you can perhaps explore or maybe should investigate. They are fundamental changes to the way in which business happens. And they're going to start happening in 2025. Now, that's the full list. I won't go through it now. I'm going to go through each of these in turn and hopefully explain to you why we think they're important and the impact they're going to have and perhaps a little bit of what you can do about it. So I'm going to start with polyfunctional robots. Now, there's a huge fashion for humanoid robots at the moment. Everyone seems to be doing them, and they're great for your share price. If you want to bump up your share price of your Tesla or Nvidia, it's a great thing to do. But from a practical point of view, humanoid isn't actually a great shape. Humans are rather poorly designed. Our knees bend the wrong way. We have too many teeth. And our eyes are not located near the things we want to pick up. So actually, we think polyfunctional robots are more important. Some of them may be humanoid, but there are many sizes and shapes and different form factors that will be used. So a polyfunctional robot, maybe humanoid, may not, but it does integrate generative AI. The point about it is that when you, a polyfunctional robot is a robot which is used for something the manufacturer or the designer did not envisage. If you make a robot for screwing the tops on toothpaste tubes, then you can sell to all the toothpaste tube manufacturers. Fantastic. But if you make a robot which can do lots of different things, you can sell lots of different people. And then you get economies of scale and more functionality. And economies of scale means more production and standardized form factors and so forth. Reduced cost of development. So the focus now is not really on the cost of the robot, it's the cost of deployment. How much it costs to deploy the robot. How soon after the robot arrives in your site, in your factory, in your office, does it start generating revenue or saving money or whatever it is that it's doing? And that's where the GenAI comes in. The ability to program the robot on the fly. You can't have a robot arrive and then spend 2 months developing software for it. That's not what we're doing now. The robot arrives, you tell it what to do, possibly through an interface, possibly through voice, whatever, and it immediately starts getting on with it and generating value. So polyfunctional robots deliver a much better return on investment. They're versatile, they can do lots of different things, and they are really going to be huge. Some of them may be humanoid, but humanoid is not a big deal. Like I said, humans, fairly poorly designed. In fact, if we look at the robots being deployed by people like Amazon, they're not really humanoid. Their knees bend the wrong way because humans are poorly designed. And we see robots with eyes in their fingertips, which is a much more sensible place to put an eye than in a head 3 feet away from the thing you're trying to pick up. So polyfunctional robots are going to be really critical. But equally critical, or possibly even more so, is going to be a lack of energy. There isn't enough power for the applications that we want to develop and that we want to use. In fact, we're saying by 2026, over 30% of all data center expansion will be delayed through lack of power. And it's not just the power itself, it's the distribution and transmission of that power, getting it to the right place. We're already seeing data centers being built, located, new data centers being located near power supplies, near power stations, be they hydroelectric dams, solar plants, or indeed nuclear power stations or anything else. Because getting power to the data center is becoming critical. Overall, the demand is exceeding supply. There isn't enough power. And of course, AI is a factor here. AI, the training of the large language models, generates obviously a huge power consumption. But it's not just that. overall, data centers, even before the AI boom, data centers were consuming too much energy. And like I said, it's not just about generating, it's distribution and transmission, local power generation. It also becomes a political problem. We've seen that when a data center has tried to sign a priority deal with the local power company saying, okay, you know, if power gets tight, we get priority access. That sits very bad politically because now you're talking about cutting off power to homes in order to power data centers. And that's politically difficult. So it's going to be very hard to get those service level agreements. And overall pricing of power is going to increase. Now, of course, we are seeing a return to nuclear power. We're seeing development of small modular nuclear power plants. And of course, we're going to see more use of fossil fuels, particularly in the States where legislation is making that easier. But those are short-term. Well, that's a short-term solution, obviously. The nuclear power may be a longer-term solution. And of course, companies such as Microsoft are investing heavily in fusion power, which would be great if it works, when it works. It's been 20 years away for a very long time now. So power is going to become a critical factor. And when you're building a data center or siting a data center or using a data center, you need to think, where is the electricity coming from and how reliable and dependable is that supply? Moving into another area, cybersecurity. At Gartner, we spend a lot of time, obviously, looking at cybersecurity. We have a fairly large team that just does it. And new technologies present new risks. But one of the big shifts is away from detect and respond to preemptive cybersecurity. In fact, we think that by 2030, 50% of IT security spending, 50% of the money that you spend on IT security will be aimed at preemptive solutions, not detecting solutions, not detecting attacks or responding to attacks, but actually preemptively preparing your network for attacks. So a good example of that, and if anyone's been in security a long time, you remember that they have a thing called a honeypot. And what you do is you create a server you make the server, you put some interesting files on it, you make it like an attractive server, you put it on your network, but none of your legitimate users touch it. A hacker comes in, starts looking around your network, they see the server loaded with nice things, they attach to it, and immediately you know you've got an attack. So you preemptively, you've created a honeypot and you've lured the hacker into it. Problem with honeypots, they take a while to create. You've got to put effort in. You've got to build it. You've got to make it look convincing. But GenAI can do all of that for you. Now you can go ChatGPT and create 1,000 honeypots. Now the hacker comes in and sees 1,000 servers, 999 of which are not used by any of your legitimate users. And if they touch the wrong one, they set off the alarm. So in that way, this is an example of how preemptive security becomes more important than responding to attacks. Automated moving target defense is what we call it. This is the ability to change your network dynamically and predict your threats. We're also seeing AIs used to do attack pattern analysis and prediction, creating simulations of attacks, working out what the effect would be if somebody hacked into your network or disabled some of your systems, and what effect would you expect that to have. So like I said, responsive cybersecurity is not going to be good enough. And you should be asking your cybersecurity vendors, do you have a plan for preemptive cybersecurity? And if they don't, look around, because you're going to be spending 50% of your spending on preemptive. And if your current vendor doesn't offer it, you may need to think about that.
Hi, I'm Mary Massaglio, a Vice President Distinguished Analyst at Gartner. I've led several sessions at many Gartner conferences through the years. And if there's one thing I can say about them, it's that attending them is the best way to stay ahead of the competition. Each conference I've been to provides attendees with invaluable insights and ideas, and the content is always relevant and tailored to key issues being faced by leaders in every core business, be it finance, HR, sales, IT, supply chain, or marketing. Join me at a Gartner conference to learn about emerging trends and gain new perspectives that you won't be able to find anywhere else. Leave our conferences ready to contribute more at work, and most importantly, be equipped with the skills to turn new ideas into action. Visit gartner.com/conferences or the link in the description of this podcast to learn more.
In the GenAI side, domain-specific language models are going to be better than large language models. In fact, we think, again, 2030, 90% of GenAI-enabled solutions will use domain-specific language models, DSLMs. Now, these domain-specific language models are much smaller than the sort of ChatGPTs and things of that, Geminis of this world. But they're much more able to operate within a specific environment. They have objectives and they know what they're doing. Specialists. Just what you need. Specialized models for specific tasks. Let me give you an example. When ChatGPT recently introduced an action model, and it was great, you could say to ChatGPT, set an alarm for 10 minutes time. And it might. But it might not, because it's an AI and it doesn't always act the way you expect. Large language models don't. So most of the time, the alarm will go off in 10 minutes, but not every time. And frankly, that's not very useful. When I ask for an alarm to be set, I want the alarm to be set. So a limited language model, and in that case, a sort of basic Alexa, can handle that sort of task. And that's an extreme example of a limited language model, but it is effective for that task. So specialized models for specific tasks and embedded intelligent applications and action models. They'll compete on ecosystems. The other thing, of course, the large language models, they're not going to be very many of them. It's going to be, you know, three or four dominated by the very large companies. And then everyone else is just going to have to use smaller models because the competition, the efficiencies and the ecosystems are going to be in the small language models. Oh, sorry, we don't like to use the word small. Domain-specific language models, I should be clear on that. That's what's going to be more important. And GenAI is going to be everywhere. We should be very clear on that. Having said that, we don't believe that it's going to be standalone products like the sort of ChatGPT monthly subscription model. People aren't going to pay $20 to chat with an AI. It's going to be built in to applications. That by 2029, 4 years away, 50% of enterprise business process interactions will leverage language models. Doesn't mean that you'll be paying a subscription to a language model. You'll still be buying software. It will just make use of a language model. And like I said, mainly domain specific. And traditional software is going to be refactored. It's going to be redesigned to create composable generative AI solutions. So multimodal, nonlinear interfacing. There'll be a context for the interaction rather than just going in, completing a task and finishing that task. There'll be dynamic interoperability across IT systems. And it is, you know, obviously this is kind of low code, no code. This is creating new applications using generative AI, but it's a new way of working, a new way of interfacing. And this will replace sequential workflows. And that's what, you know, you should be doing is looking at how you could leverage this. Let's go on. Disinformation as a new InfoSec discipline. By 2030, we think disinformation will be as big a business threat as information security breaches. Disinformation could damage your business very badly. One of my favorite examples is there was a shampoo called Wash and Go. Wash and Go, combined shampoo and conditioner. It's very popular. Wash and Go. And they launched it in Russia, hugely popular in Russia. This is before the internet goes way back. And to the point at which there was actually a cocktail called the Wash and Go. You know, people were, the brand was so well known, so widely understood. And people loved it and used it. And then this rumor started that it made your hair fall out. Now, there was no truth to this, but the rumor took hold. And like I said, I'm pre-internet. I'm not talking chat rooms. We're just talking about conversations. And they couldn't stop it. And they couldn't control it. And they couldn't manage it. And eventually, the managing director of the company was forced to appear on national television to assure everyone that Wash and Go did not make your hair fall out. Of course, being Russians, they watched that and thought immediately that it must make your hair fall out, and the company was forced to withdraw the product. So a rumor like that could destroy an entire product. And of course, that was before the internet. As we all know, ChatGPT and or GenAI can generate a huge amount of traffic maligning a product or a person or your managing director or anything like that. And the question is, how are you going to control it? It's a book called World Without Truth. It's just about to be published. It's not been published yet. It's currently with the editors. It's by three Gartner analysts looking at this particular problem. Dave, Andrew, and Richard have written a book about this particular issue because we do think it's so significant. The very concept of truth and fact are under attack. When you send out a press release from your company, you send it to a journalist. Do you digitally sign it? I don't think you do. I'm assuming you don't. I can't see you, of course, but most people don't. And so how do you know that the journalist received it? How does the journalist know it really came from you? Well, they can see the from address. The faking from addresses in email is really quite trivial. So how does the journalist know that press release really came from you? Maybe they'll check. Maybe they'll phone you up. If they've got time, they will. But how many journalists have time these days? So think about that. When you're sending out new information, how do you know it's real? How do they know it's real? How does the person you're sending it to know that it's real? Because it isn't always. Major business disruption. And it's outside your perimeter. These are attacks which are not originating. You know, it's not somebody attacking your firewall or attacking your systems. It's the big wide world out there they're using and the social networks. And they're becoming increasingly sophisticated. It's not just bad-mouthing your products. It's more complex than that. So disinformation is going to be a really important thing. And already there are companies setting up tools that can identify sources of content that can help you manage the narrative that's taking place outside your company borders and on the public internet.
Thanks for listening to this latest episode of ThinkCast. That was Gartner Distinguished VP Analyst Bill Ray. To learn more about emerging technologies and to watch the full webinar, follow the links in the notes. ThinkCast will be back wherever you listen to podcasts a week from today. In the meantime, please rate, review, subscribe, and share with a colleague so neither of you will miss it.
ThinkCast is a production of Gartner. This podcast may not be reproduced or distributed in any form without Gartner's permission. It consists of the opinions of Gartner's research organization, which should not be construed as statements of fact. Content provided by other speakers is expressly the views of the speaker and/or their organization. While the information contained in this podcast has been obtained from sources believed to be reliable, Gartner disclaims all warranties as to the accuracy, completeness, or adequacy of such information. Although Gartner Research may address legal and financial issues, Gartner does not provide legal or investment advice, and its research should not be construed or used as such.